Hello everyone, I welcome you all to my YouTube channel. This is lecture 2 of this series. We'll be dealing regarding AC traction in this. AC traction system is used mainly in mainline and in some of the metros. First we'll understand how the power enters into our traction substation. So the power flows from a grid substation which is nearby, and this voltage at grid substation is either 220 kV, 132 or 66 kV. This high voltage then flows through cables or overhead lines and enters into our receiving substation. This I have shown bidirectional, as sometimes the power from the traction substation goes back to the grid, that is a part of regenerative braking. Now, in RSS, once the supply comes, it is divided into two. First, the part goes into the auxiliary system, which is for station lighting, signaling, comm, and other supplies. And the other one is used for traction. For traction, 132 kV voltage is converted into 27.5 kV. Now, in this auxiliary, this is a three-phase voltage, a three-phase supply, whereas in traction that is line to line. There is no third phase. So once we get this 132 kV supply, then this line to line supply of 132 kV is converted into 27.5 kV via traction transformer. Then this 27.5 kV is fed to the overhead contact system and running rails. The train is running between this, and then inside the train, this high voltage of 27.5 kV gets converted into a low voltage. So this all is single phase, remember. Now this single phase voltage is fed into the system for other lighting purposes and some other auxiliary use, and also it is fed to a rectifier to get it converted into DC. Then this DC voltage gets converted into AC via inverter and then fed to the induction motor, which is three phase. As we are not having any single phase induction or single phase motor, we are using three phase, that's why we convert this AC voltage to DC, and then we can shape it in any form and get a three phase voltage. To have a better feel of this, why we are converting from AC to DC and DC to AC, you can refer to my previous lecture for DC traction, which is the lecture 1 of this series. Now, I will show you a simplified circuit diagram for how this system works. So once we have got this 132 kV in the high voltage side of the transformer, this 132 kV is line to line. If someone asks you what is the line to ground voltage, then you have to show that it is 132 by root 3. This high voltage is converted into low voltage of 27.5 kV, which is being fed to the overhead contact system, and this is your return system. Now this voltage can be either 17.5 here and minus 10 kV. So you will be getting 27.5 as the difference between these two points, or it can be 15 and this can be 12.5 kV, minus 12.5 kV. But to avoid this, what we do, we earth this point. Once you connect this point to earth, then you will get 27.5 kV at this point. So now you can see that this is your overhead contact system, the red line, and the pantograph takes this supply and which enters into the train, and then from the wheels via running rails it gets returned back to its source from where it started. So this is how your loop is getting completed. You can relate it with your example at your home itself. how the light bulb glows. There is a 230 volt supply coming from phase and neutral as your return, and this light bulb then starts glowing. There's a switch in between, and this switch, if you turn it on, then the circuit gets completed. So similarly, you can assume your phase here as your 227.5 kV, and your neutral, which is your return system for your home appliances, can act as your running rail in this 25 kV traction system. Now I'll be giving you a cross-section overview of this. This is your mast, which is grounded either through a separate earth plate or through earth conductors, which is overhead protective conductor OPC, AEW, which is aerial earth wire. Both are same, just there are different wordings for them. But this complete earthing system we'll be dealing separately in a lecture. What all the wires are going, what all the cables we have to install for earthing, but just giving you an overview here. And then through insulators, catenary and contact is connected. Why we are using these insulators is because this is 27.5 kV supply. You cannot directly connect to the mast, as it will be earthed and this will become a fault. These are your running rails, which are acting as your return system here. Now we move on to another simplified circuit diagram. This is the way we'll be dealing ahead in other lectures. This is a simplified model, but in later series we'll be dealing in some complex models in order to analyze the circuits, the fault conditions, as well as in design calculations. This is a source which is 27.5 kV, the transformer secondary. This is your contact wire resistance and reactance. Reactance is nothing but 2 pi f is your frequency, supply frequency, into the inductance. I have not taken mutual impedance in this, as it will be a little complicated, so just taken this part. And for return system, it will be R, and this will be your reactance, and the current is flowing like this in the loop. This L is your train or rolling stock. So you see that current is flowing through this return system and it is connected to earth at this point. So there must be a voltage at this point B, because current always flows from higher potential to lower potential. So you can see the voltage at point B by applying Kirchhoff's voltage law. It will be VB minus the impedance in times current equal to this voltage at point O. As O is connected to earth, so this value will become zero, and then this VB will be equal to I times the impedance of the return system, which is nothing but this. So now you got the value of rail potential. So now you might be thinking that if somebody touches these rails, then he must be electrocuted, as there are a lot of people who are trying to jump on the tracks to go to the other platform, or they try to leave the station by jumping on the tracks and go outside. But why they are not getting electrocuted, or they are not getting shocks? This is the responsibility of an earthing bonding engineer in order to make this value to be reasonably low. And the value is mentioned in the EN standard 50122-1. This is a basic railway standard for AC and DC traction. As we are dealing with AC in this lecture, the value for the rail potential acceptable is 60 volts. This is for continuous time, long duration. Whereas in case of fault, suppose you assume that there is a fault in this. a fault has occurred. So they'll be, instead of I, the current that will be flowing will be IF. So this value will rise because now the current, as it is directly proportional to voltage, has increased because it's a fault. So this voltage will rise. So for short duration, but as the fault is only for short duration because there is a circuit breaker here inside the substation which will trip in case of fault. So the for short duration, I'll give you an example. It is 480 volts for 300 milliseconds, but you can go and check the table in this standard and you will find in clause 9 and 10 that for different time intervals there is different voltages there. So accordingly we design our system. Now what we can do in order to avoid this voltage? See, there's a human being who is trying to touch, a person is trying to touch with his hands to the running rail which is having some voltage VB, and there is some voltage VC where he is standing, we can assume 1 meter apart. So this will be the voltage across his body. This has to be limited to this volt value. But what we can do in order to decrease this VB? As this VB is directly proportional to the current and also directly proportional to the impedance of the return system. So either we can decrease the current flowing through the running rails, or we can decrease the current, or we can decrease the impedance. So in order to decrease the current, we will create some parallel paths. That is, suppose this is your running rail which is having some resistance, and if I connect another conductor in parallel to it, the current will get shared by these both conductors. So hence, initially if the current was flowing I, now it will be, if we assume both the resistance as same, it will be I by 2 and I by 2. Thus the potential will get reduced. Similarly, we can also do cross bonding, that is bonding track 1. These are the two running rails for up track and this is the two running rails for down track, and we cross bond them at certain intervals. Suppose this is X, and this X can be either 1 kilometer or 600 meters or 450 meters or 300 meters. This depends upon the simulation and which we'll be discussing later. This is one of the way of reducing the impedance and also current sharing. So we'll be discussing more into it. What are the practical ways of how to reduce this potential, and also what are the ways that are mentioned in this standard 50122-1. I hope you have got an overview of how AC traction works and DC traction in my previous lecture. So we'll be moving ahead now on individual equipment design and how the circuit diagram looks like and how we have to perform all those calculations and using the IEC's, IEEE's, IEEE standards, and how the formulas have been mentioned in this standard. We'll be getting to know that. So thank you for listening, and God bless you all.